Redline is a popular and well-liked anime. It's a favorite of mine, and not a controversial one. Trava Fist Planet, on the other hand, is a surprisingly different case. For being the original work from which Redline is technically a spin-off and made by a lot of the same talented staff, it's rare to see it given more than a passing glance, and a fairly unsightly mouse score serves to warn away curious newcomers. Yet, despite all this, it's also a favorite of mine. I'm tempted to say that's baffling, but to be honest, there are some fairly obvious reasons it's so underrated. Before I get to that, though, I should explain why Trava Fist Planet is worth your time. Trava Fist Planet is an OVA about Trava Stila Anister, or Trava, and his mechanic named, Right, Shinkai. Two former soldiers in some large-scale space war who say they were kicked out for being too good. They're on a mission to survey an unknown region as they try to raise funds to join in the titular Fist Planet Robot Fighting Power Tournament. On their journey, they discover a mysterious capsule with an amnesiac girl, fight giant monsters with some awesome technology, find themselves embroiled in a mythical tale foretold by a race of giants, and have some mean-spirited fun incessantly ribbing Shinkai. While one might go in expecting something similar to Redline, Trava stands out as its own production with different goals in mind. The colors and shading feel a lot more like Imaishi's directorial debut, Dead Leaves, and while there isn't too much staff overlap between the two, I can't help but suspect Imaishi's vision was at least in part inspired by his work on Trava. And, like Dead Leaves, this OVA is densely packed with joyrides, altercations, goofs, and gags that are brimming with creativity. Yet, despite the sheer intensity of the action, the spastic nature of the characters, and the distinctness of basically every shot, Trava goes for a surprisingly sleepy, relaxed vibe. Its broad but muted color palette gives it a sense of softness, even with its sharp angles and heavy foreshortening, and the characters laze around and talk like they're half asleep all the time. Weirdly enough, it ends up being a sort of comfy watch.
Shinkai-kun. Ocha.
This bizarre juxtaposition inherent to the OVA's vision is honestly my favorite thing about it. It's so unlike anything else I've seen, and the technical prowess of the staff responsible allows them to realize it perfectly. So, who is that staff? Directed by Takeshi Koike. Obviously, you've got Takeshi Koike, the man who can do no wrong. But on Trava, he was actually one of two directors alongside Katsuhito Ishii. For context, this is a guy who directed Party 7, the live-action film with an animated opening that put Koike on the map. But Ishii has worked on both live-action and animated projects, and has continued to have a working relationship with Koike. Not only did he direct Trava, but he also wrote the story for Redline alongside collaborating on its script, mechanical design, and providing its incredible character designs. People always talk up how Redline is Koike's brainchild, but it's just as much Ishii's film too. Speaking of Ishii, it's worth mentioning the vocal cast. Most of the voice actors in Trava were actually live-action performers in his two previous films, and had no experience in anime. Despite, or perhaps in part because of this, their performances are one of the best and most distinct aspects of Trava. The dialogue is delivered in that sleepy casual tone so convincingly by the cast to great comedic effect. Each voice matches its character so well, and that's thanks in no small part to Ishii's existing connections from his previous body of work that allowed him to bring this talent on board. But there's more. Telling you that Trava and Redline share a lot of staff may be enough to convince you of its quality, but I'd like to go over some specific roles that stood out to me. On storyboarding, we see Takeshi Koike alongside Sayu Yamamoto, Hiroyuki Imaishi, and Hiroyuki Kitakubo. The range of experience for each member of this group is really interesting. Yamamoto has made a name for herself nowadays with Michiko Tohachin, Yuri on Ice, and the woman called Fujiko Mine, but Trava was one of the first projects she worked on after joining the industry. Koike and Imaishi hadn't directed much yet, but they'd proven themselves in the industry for a number of years as key animators, all the while Kitakubo had already directed Rojin Z, Blood the Last Vampire, Golden Boy, and more. In terms of key animation, some of the most notable folks include, once again, Hiroyuki Imaishi, as well as Yo Yoshinari, Takafumi Hori, and Hiroshi Hamasaki. It's common knowledge that Yoshinari and Imaishi are currently the big boys at Studio Trigger, but much of that studio's work had also seen contributions from Hori, who did a lot of key animation on Kill la Kill and served as Little Witch Academia's animation director. Hamasaki, on the other hand, who had previously key animated on a number of Madhouse projects alongside Koike, has since done a lot of cool work, directing Steins Gate and Technolize, among a number of other things. There's a fair amount that stood out to me which I haven't mentioned here, so if you're interested, I'd highly recommend checking it out yourself. Cross-referencing the careers of each of these creatives, made especially easy by a fully English credit sequence, is itself very interesting. Anything with a team like this is bound to be awesome. It's likely you're already a fan of many of these people's work, and Trava carries all their joint passion and vision in one OVA. So, what was I going to talk about? Oh, right, it's time to complain about a 3-year-old Super Eye Patch Wolf video. So, I have to preface that I'm really a pretty new anime fan. I only started watching in 2015 and have yet to delve as deep into the classics as I'd like to. Fortunately, for 2017 me, I found this cool YouTuber who made a video about a neat film called Redline. It's possible this was my first introduction to Redline, and his brief mention of Trava was certainly my first exposure to that, which I'm sure is also true for many in his wide audience. Here's what he has to say about it.
But the reason I bring it up is that you can see the various weaknesses in the team's production at this point. A lot of the shots feel very flat and the animation is quite limited. The vision and style is most definitely there, but it's the technique that was lacking. And it's this lack of technique that Koike and his team at Madhouse would spend the next 7 years working up and improving upon.
Someone's having doubts, huh? Hell, I'm just trying to keep this thing interesting. You can't write me off like that. It's just a voice, pal. You don't know a damn thing about
how Trava Fist Planet is actually good, though. Firstly, and obviously, this sells Trava far short. The diagnosis of lacking technique in particular is frankly bizarre. A cursory look at the staff tells you they had plenty of technique by the time they worked on Trava, which is plainly evident when you actually watch it. There are plenty of standout cuts of animation, and the consistent quality of its versatile, hyper-stylized character art without any flubs or fudges is a testament to the quality of the production at large. In fact, the same team made a teaser for a second episode of Trava that was never produced, which contains animation and aesthetic that's much closer to what they eventually went for in Redline, proving that the approach to the first episode of Trava was a conscious choice as opposed to the regretful output of an inexperienced team. But secondly, and the reason why I'm rambling about this in the first place, this brief dismissal of Trava is such a missed opportunity. The first time I watched Trava was when planning to show Redline to some friends. I suggested we watch the original OVA beforehand. By doing this, we not only got to see the aesthetic roots from which Redline was derived, but we were also greatly endeared to the antics and dynamics of Trava and Shinkai. In the following viewing of Redline, it was so exciting and even more hilarious to see JP and Sonoshi's tender moment get derailed by Shinkai's sudden and tone-deaf introduction. Not only that, but now I had so much more context and investment in the dynamics between Trava, Shinkai, and the Redline-exclusive character Little Daisuna, the last of which was already my favorite character in the film. Hell, one of my friend's primary complaints with Redline is that we don't get to see enough of the cast from Trava. It might seem strange that I'm getting so worked up over a short, passively negative clip from a pretty old YouTube video. Just, as I said before, I'm disappointed at the opportunity that was missed here. They convinced me not to bother watching Trava when I first saw it. Who knows how many others had the same takeaway. This video is certainly not his biggest, but his reach and influence are undeniable. As far as I could find, this is by far the most popular mention of Trava on YouTube. The only other analytical or review content is this video from Hamon Beat. It's a nice, to-the-point video that's very fair, positive, and informative for its length. It just doesn't have all that many views. Well, it's got far more than I'd ever expect it yet, but the point is I think it deserves more. There's also this incredibly brief mention from 2012 Glass Reflection, which...
It's not like any of them have their own side story episodes or something. Oh, wait.
Okay. Why does he sound angry? What? Arcata, why are you angry about that? Is that not a cool thing? Huh? What I'm getting at is, as a big fan of this OVA and someone who thinks that there are a lot more people who would be glad to have seen it, it's disappointing that Trava is so under-discussed despite its connection to Redline. And it's not like that's something you can really blame a handful of YouTubers for. It's an obscure DVD release from 2003, never localized or re-released, with intentions and eccentricities that make its appeal far more niche than that of its follow-up. Still, you'd think something like this would at least have a strong enough undercurrent of fans to get talked about more than it is, especially when, in my experience at least, it just adds to the enjoyment of something that was already a favorite. All I can hope is that someday it will get a more high-profile shoutout that gives credit for all that's so cool about it. Returning to that Super Eye Patch Wolf video, he put it best in his own words.
Which is why I wanted to make this video. I think it's important to recognize when a group of passionate and talented people create something special, which is exactly what happened with Redline.
And that's exactly what happened with Trava, too. Also, Shades, you are obligated to show this video to the secret cabal of any tubers watching Digest. Don't do it for me, do it for Trava. I listened to that episode of the Trash Chase podcast. There's gotta be at least one person out there who will get Trava the recognition it deserves. Come on, man, really, it's not for me, it's for Trava, I'm begging you.